Hello everyone, and welcome to this video lecture in which I will derive for you the equations of motion of a double mass spring damper system. This is basically the 2 degree of freedom variation on the single degree of freedom mass spring damper system that we discussed in the previous lecture. So let me start off by sketching the system. Here we have the fixed world. And then we have a spring and a damper attached to a first point mass. Then we have a second spring and damper combination attached to a second point mass, which is then finally also attached to the fixed world on the other side of the system. The point masses are M1 and M2, the spring coefficients K1, K2, and K3, damping coefficients T1, D2, and D3. And I will also consider the fact that there are external forces acting on the individual point masses F1 and F2. I draw them on top of the point masses because otherwise the figure becomes a little bit messy. Okay, so I think it's clear that this system has 2 degrees of freedom, n dof is equal to 2, and that the independent coordinates are x1 and x2, which denote the position of both the point masses. I will take them both to the right as positive, like so. Okay, now in order to derive the equations of motion, we need to make free body diagrams. And since we have 2 point masses now, we need free body diagrams of both point masses. So 2 free body diagrams. Okay, so that is the next step, free body diagrams. In a positive deflected state, so I will draw mass 1 here, slightly to the right. And let's now consider what forces are acting on M1. So of course, we still have this F1. And we have a spring force Fs1 pulling back, a damper force Fd1 opposing the motion as well. And of course, we also have a second spring force and a second damper force. Let's be very careful about in which direction they act, how to deal with this. Well, for this, I will currently assume that mass 2 remains at its position. Okay, so in that case, these will be the directions of Fs2 and Fd2. Okay, so this is how I establish the directions. Then if I make a free body diagram of M2, which I will now allow to move, okay, we have F2 as external force. Now, for Fs2 and Fd2, I cannot make a choice anymore. I have to obey now that I decided to draw them in these directions, because these spring and damper force 2 must obey Newton's third law. So then we still have the third spring and damper force. They are opposing the motion Fs3 and Fd3. Okay, very well. Next up is that I establish the relation for these spring and damper forces. So for the spring force 1, I think it's evident that this is simply K1 times X1. But Fs2 is slightly more complicated. It is something with K2. And the force in the spring is something with spring stiffness times the elongation, and the elongation of the spring is in this case the difference between x1 and x2. But should it be x1 minus x2 or the other way around? Well, for this it is very important that we match this expression with the direction of the arrow that I draw in the free body diagram. So remember what I just said when I made these arrows. I consider these arrows first by assuming that mass 2 does not move. And then the force in the negative x direction on mass 1 is k2 times x1. Okay, but then if I allow x2 to move in the positive x direction as well, this force is going to be less. So it's x1 minus x2, like this. You can also do this reasoning the other way around. So what is important is that the direction of the arrows in the free body diagrams match with this expression. If I have if I would write k2 times x2 minus x1, that's also fine, but then I should also flip the direction of the arrows in the free body diagram. Okay, so make sure that these are consistent with each other. That's the bottom line. And then finally, for the third spring, we have k3 times x2. Okay, well, for the dampers, the story is very similar, so let me just write that down. We have d1 times x1 dot. For the force in the second damper, we have d2 times the difference in velocities, x1 dot minus x2 dot. And then we have fd3, which is d3 times x2 dot. Okay. So we have the free body diagrams, we have expressions for all the forces. This is the time that we can apply Newton's second law. And we are going to apply it on each of the free body diagrams. So starting with the first one, we have the sum of all forces, which should in the end be equal to mass 1 times acceleration 1. Now, what are all the forces? We have the spring forces minus F S1 minus FS2. We have the damper forces minus FD1 minus FD2. And we have the external force plus F1. Okay, then for the second point mass, second free body diagram, we also write down Newton's second law, which should be equal to M2 times X2 double dot. And then we have plus FS2 minus FS3 plus FD2 minus FD3 plus F2. Okay, so these are the force balances, the Newton equations, and now we can substitute the expressions for the spring and damper forces in these equations. Okay, what you will see is that all these forces contain x1, x2, or their time derivatives. I will take all these terms to the left-hand side of the equation, and I will slightly rearrange it. So basically, I will group all terms with x1 dot, all the terms with x2 dot, all the terms with x1, and all the terms with x2. So the remaining equation will look like this. And you might want, if it goes too fast, just when I have written down the entire equation, pause the video and make sure that you're happy with how I rewrote these equations, okay? So rewriting the first equation, we have mass 1, x double dot 1. And then we have a contribution from both the first and the second damper that both contain something with x dot 1. And we have a contribution of the second damper with x2 dot, which is negative. And for the spring, something similar. We have k1 and k2 that are both multiplied by x1. And we have in a negative contribution of k2 times x2. And this is equal to f1. Okay. Now, for the second equation, substituting all these expressions in the second force balance, we have mass 2 times x double dot 2. Then we have minus d2 times x1 dot. And we have plus d2 and d3 times x2 dot. we have minus k2 times x1, and we have plus k2 and k3 times x2, and this is equal to f2. Okay, these equations are the equations of motion of the double mass spring damper system. And I think what is important to mention is that these are, they form a set of second order ODEs, because the highest time derivatives are still one, but these ODEs are coupled. Maybe I should write that down. These are coupled ODEs. What do I mean with that? Well, they are coupled in the sense that we do not have just one equation for x1 and another equation for x2, but x1 and x2 appear in both equations. So that means that if we start thinking about solving such an equation, we need to think of a way to solve for x1 and x2 simultaneously at the same time. We cannot do first x1 and then x2. We need to think of another way of doing that. However, the coefficients are still constants, the equations are still linear, and they are inhomogeneous because of f1 and f2. Okay, now this is also a standard equation of motion that we will use a lot when we turn our attention to second degree of freedom systems. I think this concludes the lecture. See you in the next one.